Amen. Bless the Lord. Church is now called to worship. What shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits towards me? I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord for his good, for his mercies endureth forever. Let's sing the doxology.
Glory be to the Father and to
into your courts this blessed Sabbath day. We ask now that you will fill us with the infilling of your Holy Spirit, and let your name be magnified, let your name be glorified, is our humble prayer in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The opening song is 281, I give my life wholly to A1.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Psalm 27. Psalm 27, and we will read responsively from verses 1 to 7. Psalm 27, reading responsively from verses 1 to 7. I begin. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell.
Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident.
One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple.
For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock.
And now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord.
Together, hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me.
Amen.
We come before thee now. At your feet we humbly bow. We are thankful that we have come at your invitation and that you are so glad, ready, and willing to hear. This morning we thank you for our spared lives. We thank you for the eternal plan of salvation which was put in place at the foundation of the world. We thank you for all the lovely things you made for us to enjoy. Our cool, clear water, our fresh breezes, the sunshine, all the lovely trees, flowers, and everything. Thank you for providing our daily food. Without it, we would die. Similarly situated, we need your words. Your words enlighten our pathway. It makes us see where we can go until at last we reach to your kingdom when you come. We give you thanks, dear Lord, for your love. We give you thanks that that Son who was slain from the foundation of the world did come in our flesh, our blood, our nature, and he overcame Satan, showing us an example that we also can overcome him. And that we do not live by our physical food only, but we live by every word which proceeds from your mouth. We give you thanks, dear God, that you have brought us in your courts this morning. We thank you for this grand privilege. We thank you for every member. Thank you for our pastor and his family members. We thank you for all our visiting friends who could have been otherwise at places differently, but they have come to sup at your table with us. And we are praying that you would bless all of us and give them an extra special blessing. We pray for our young children, our little babies. We pray for the youth and the teenagers. We pray for the middle age, the older ones, the golden ages, and the senior citizens. Help us all to take our time to love you and to love one another. We are praying, Lord, that you will bless those who are sick among us, those who are absent and could not be here. We are praying, Lord, that you will help us to be reverent in your sanctuary, that we would lift you up and we will gather every word that you have given to your manservant, Pastor McDonald, that, dear Lord, you would continue to bless him. You will continue to shower your graces upon him. You will anoint him and you will give him wisdom from on high. And let the words that you have laid on his heart, that you have spoken to him to tell us, help, dear Lord, that by your grace, with clarity, with great expression, and with conviction, he'll be able to put it out, these words out to us, so that we would listen, your Holy Spirit accompanying what he says and what we receive, and we'll all be richly, richly blessed. We are praying for churches around this island that you would bless services that are held everywhere and help that your people would be richly blessed. We are asking you, Lord, to please forgive us for our sins, because we usually sin against you by the way we think, by the things we say and what we do. So we are praying for your cleansing, dear loving Heavenly Father. We are also praying that you will give us victory. And this victory comes in Jesus. Help us to agonize with him in prayer, read his words, trust in him, and ask him to help us to overcome Satan, because he's wronged about us trying to destroy us. We are asking you, dear Lord, to help us to have a very, very pleasant sitting, enjoying our meal round about your table. And we are asking you, dear Lord, that when time shall give place to eternity, that we will be very happy to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of thy Lord." Come and spend eternity with me. And when I transform my kingdom to the New Jerusalem on earth, all my lovely children will be there, thanking God for his love, for him having sent Jesus to die in our stead, and for giving us a home eternally. We thank you for hearing, and we thank you for answering. And we praise your name here and now, and we are sure by your grace we are going to praise it without sin through eternity, through Christ our precious Lord. Amen.
Good morning, saints of God.
Good morning.
This morning we are privileged to have the opportunity to come to worship God in his tabernacle. Privilege is mine to welcome every brother, every sister. But among us we have special guests, and we want to give a special welcome. Could all our guests kindly stand? We want to acknowledge you. Could all our guests, everywhere we have lots of guests, could you please stand? We want to just recognize you and share our love with you. Let's say amen.
Amen.
I have secured some books for you, some priority magazines, and our deacon right in the front is going to help me share them to all. Keep standing, please. Keep standing. So we can give you. So we are happy to have you this morning. Welcome back our student from USC. We're happy to have you, Brother Carson, Sister Peters. I saw you. We are very privileged to have with us also Sister Trotman from Canada. We're happy to have you. We have lots of other guests. We want to welcome you. But our welcome will not be complete except we could touch somebody's hand. So we're going to sing the song, I Love the Thrill That I Feel When I Get Together with what? God's wonderful people. Let me tell you, you are really, really wonderful. If you want to know how wonderful you are, just look up here. That's how wonderful you are. Let's sing the song, I Love the Thrill. Get up, let's get up. Go around and shake somebody's hands. Please stand, everybody stand now. And go around and make our guests feel happy. Make them feel comfortable. Nobody should be sitting now. Please stand. Let's go. Oh, praising God in the heavenly. I love the thrill that I feel when I get together with God's wonderful people. Let's sing it. I love the thrill. Stand and just jump in. Could you please stand all the way from Florida, if I have it right? Amen. We're happy to have you, Pastor Stalin and family. May God bless you as you enjoy here with us. It's offering time. It's a time when we all can participate and give the Lord what is due to Him. Bible says, the poor and the rich, the young men and the young women who earn wages, all are to lay by a portion. For God claims it. The spiritual prosperity of every member of the church depends on personal effort and strict fidelity to God. The deacons will now wait on us for the tithe offerings and gifts. House of the Lord, and stand and sing, we give thee but thine own.
We give thee but thine own.
Gracious God, you have blessed us with many gifts and talents. You have given us the ability to work, and today we have returned to you tithes, offering, and give. We pray, Holy Spirit, bless him, will open the windows of heaven in so much that there will be not sufficient room to receive us, to receive it. Bless each of us in a marvelous way, O God, and may we continue to work for you while it is day, for the night cometh when no man can walk. Continue to bless the remainder of the service. It's a humble asking with thanksgiving in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you. Be seated.
We will now have a special song by Sister McDowell.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, everyone.
A fervent prayer rose up to heaven. A fragile soul is losing ground, yet sorting through the earthly babble, heaven heard the sound. This was a life of no distinction, no successes, only trials. Yet looking down on this unloving world, there was love in heaven's eyes, in heaven's eyes. In heaven's eyes, no hopeless cause. There's only people like you with feelings like me, and they're amazed by the grace they can't find in heaven's eyes. The orphan child, the wayward father, the homeless traveler in the rain. When life goes by and no one bothers, heaven feels the pain. Looking down, God sees each heartache, shares each sorrow, and hears each cry. Yet looking up, we'll see compassion's fire ablaze in heaven's eyes, in heaven's eyes. are no losers. In heaven's eyes, no hopeless cause. There's only people like you, with feelings like me, and they're amazed by the grace they can find. In heaven's eyes, there are no losers. In heaven's eyes, no hopeless cause. There's only people like you, with feelings like me, and we're amazed by the grace we can find in heaven's eyes. And we're amazed by the grace we can find in heaven's eyes.
Thank you very much, Sister MacDonald, for that special song. In heaven's eyes, there are no losers. We know that there are only people like you, with feelings like me, in heaven's eyes. I wanted to join her, you know, but remember, I only sing solo. Solo, that no one can hear me. Happy Sabbath again, everybody. Happy Sabbath, everybody. I am so happy to see so many familiar faces. In the audience, I'm seeing familiar faces. Persons that I would have went to school with. Edison, nice seeing you, city boy, getting real big like gym every day. Nice having you here, sir. And I see your brother was here. Oh, they are here. Everybody is here. Sadie, nice having you also. And give me, but while sitting there and I look down, I'm seeing this lady and I'm watching. I'm looking and I'm looking. I took my glasses off and I'm still looking. I'm wondering if I'm really blind. When I look in the audience, when I really, really, really caught it on, it was Sister Blake. Sister Blake, stand to your feet. Put your hands together for Sister Blake, everybody. She's from Trinidad, and she works there in the theology department. And I'm telling you, Sister Blake is a good woman. She's there. She's like a mother to all those theology students. You have a problem, you can go to Sister Blake. If you want to get to Dr. Faz, go to Sister Blake first. Talk to Sister Blake, and then she will put in a word for you, and everything will be good. Everything will be okay with you. So, Sister Blake, we are happy to have you here in Mount Moriah today. Today we have a lot on our plate. We have a baby dedication. So in the next 10 minutes we'll do this baby dedication, after which we will have the Word of God. Could we have somebody escort the parents of somebody to escort the parents, one of the deacon? Okay, well, you can have a seat. You can have a seat. Thing within our church, we don't talk about godmothers and godfathers, but we know that there are persons who support a mother when they have a child. So we welcome persons who support mothers, and we also support mothers whenever they have a baby. And that's the reason we are happy that you have come by. I don't like to pronounce people's name because you can get into trouble. And I know if you call my daughter's name wrong, she will tell you what her name is. She will tell you, don't call, my name is Karis, not Carissa. It's a K, not a C, and everything else. So let me try. Devon, Duane, Duanique, Gibson. Am I correct, Mom? Same thing I'm saying. Same thing I'm saying. It's Devon. Devin. Okay, Devin. Okay, Devin. Gibson. Let me not spoil your child's name on this beautiful Sabbath day. And we are happy that this Gibson is here with her baby. And it's a good thing when a mother can bring back a child to offer to God. It's the best thing for a mother to do, or a father. Most of the time we see a mother because we always see the mothers. But the absentee landlord, we can't find them. When we go through the Bible, we realize that Samuel's mother gave him back to the Lord. We'll remember Jesus' mother took him to the temple. We'll even remember these little children coming to Jesus and his disciples stopping them saying, the master is too busy. Jesus stopped them and said to them, no, I'm not too busy for children. Let them come to me, because such is the kingdom of heaven. So we are happy that our mother today has brought her baby back to be offered up to God. In the book of Psalms, Psalms 127, verses 3 says, behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like the arrow in the hands of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man who has quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but shall speak with their enemies in the gate. Children are a heritage from God. Do we still believe that? Whether wedlock or out of wedlock, children are still a heritage from God. Because God is the one who gave us our children. And we are happy today that Miss Gibson decided to give back her child to God. Because with her doing this, she's basically saying, God gave me this child, and I'm offering him back to God. That's basically what she's saying. And she's also saying that I know the best blessing, the best way I can give back my child to God is bringing him into the house of God. We need to complement that. But the Bible says that children are a blessing from God. They are a heritage from God. And because they are a blessing from God, we need to treat them as if they are a blessing from God. We need to treat them with love and with care. We need to show them compassion, mommy, and those who have children. We need to show them love. We need to show our children love. You know, we basically say sometimes we need to just provide food, shelter, and clothing, and everything else, education. Somebody didn't hear me. These are some of the duties of our parents. A parent also needs to provide love to their children. There are too many children walking about without love. Without any parent, without any father, without any mother saying, I love you. Or without any mother showing them that they love them. Because I grew up in the age where my mother never said, I love you. But everything that she did, it showed me that she loved me. She went out of her way. And mommy, you have a big task on your hand. You are not only here to provide these physical needs of your son.
You're not only here to provide food and clothing, but you're also here to provide him with spiritual food. God gave you this child. You brought him back. You're saying, thank you, Jesus. But one of the ways that you can say thank you to Jesus is by allowing this child to grow up in the fear and the knowledge of God. One of the best ways that this child can be loved and can say that my mother did all that she can to bring me up in the fear of God is by you bringing this child to church. It's by you showing this child that I care so much about you. I'm not sending you to church now. I am bringing you to church. Now, most of the time, people, whenever they only talk, when you're beating a child, they're saying, that's child abuse. It's child abuse most of the time only goes when you're beating a child. But for me, child abuse go beyond beating a child. Preventing the child from having a proper education for me is child abuse. Preventing the child from having the proper care that this child needs is child abuse. Failing to allow God to take full control of your child's life is child abuse. So I pray that as this child grows, that you will give him everything that he needs. You will place him in the right path so that whenever you shoot, he will walk the straight and narrow path. I pray, Mommy, that your child will be a blessing not only to you, but to the community that you live in. Amen. Your child will be so much of a blessing that, as the old people say, when you look at him, you can say, well, he swelled my nose. Your child will be a blessing to the church and everyone that he comes into contact with. Why? Because you will teach him well. You will not only take a Bible and open it and place it at his head, but you will read the word of God to him. Amen. You will teach him about Jesus. You will show him, and you will tell him all that Jesus has done for you. I pray that as you continue to raise this child, that Jesus will give you the strength that you so deserve, the strength that you need so that you can go on living. And I see your two friends are here with you in support saying, I want to help you with this child. I want to be able to say to this child, God love you. I want to be able to give this child something when he don't have. I want to be able to rebuke this child. And they are here with you. But we also have a church that is here to provide support. Amen. Am I speaking the truth? Amen. To provide guidance also. So look at the church members. Is it your desires to the church members to give this child all the support that he needs so that he can grow in the fear and the knowledge of God? Amen. Amen. Mommy, I'm going to ask you this question also. Is it your desire to bring up this child in the fear of God? Not just telling him you have to go to church, but teach him true Christianity. Teach him to love. Teach him to forgive. Teach him to be compassionate. Teach him to be a good man when he grows up. Is that your desire? You have heard her and she said yes. Well, Mommy, it's a covenant between you and God. And because you have made that covenant between you and God, I pray that you will keep this covenant. You can stand.
Gracious God, creator of heaven and earth, the one who is altogether lovely, this morning we come before your awesome presence. You said, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and he shall find. This morning we patronize the mothers of Israel.
They brought the children to Jesus to be blessed, dear Lord. And this morning we have brought Devon before you, O God, Devin. We ask you, Father, to bless him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. Lord, we ask you to provide physical strength. Every organ, every tissue, Lord, bless the organs that they'll function effectively. Give him intelligent, Lord, that he'll be able to learn effectively in school. More so, give him a good moral ability, a capability, Lord, so he can learn from those around him the good things. I pray, dear Father, that he will shun evil by the influences around him. Bless his environment this morning, that he'll grow up influenced by the things around him for the good. And especially bring his parent before thee, O Lord. You have guided her through 9 months of pregnancy. You have given her safe delivery. And Father, you didn't bring her this far to leave her. You who have begun the good work in her, Lord, you're able to complete it and you're able to prepare Devon for citizenship in heaven. So this morning, we pray for you to provide for him, O God, physically, spiritually, mentally, and otherwise. Keep him from drugs and alcohol, O God. Keep him from premarital sex and all of these things that influence young people these days. Lord, I pray that you'll bless him in so much that he'll be known and read of all men as a child of yours. I pray that, Lord, he'll bless those around him, his brothers, his sisters, his aunts, his uncles, those with whom he associates, Lord. I pray that he'll chart his future as you promised to give us an expected end. Please give Devon an expected end, O Lord. Make him the head and not the tail. Give him a full basket that he'll never be empty. Grant that he'll have to lend and never borrow. Grant, O God, that he will learn in school, he'll top his class, Lord. And most of all, make him a citizen of heaven. Make him a preacher of your word, Lord. Call him as you call Elijah. Call him as you call Isaiah. Call him as he called Jeremiah, Lord. May he stand up for you and be counted among great men in heaven. Father, bless us today. Grant us a church. We'll support this little child. We'll care for him. We'll give him love. We'll give him everything that he needs that will make him a great person on this earth. Bless us one and all. And when time shall end in eternity, grant that all of us bowing here, including Devin and his mom and everyone else, will hail you as Lord and Master, is a humble asking in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. We'll call the church clock at this moment. And if the children ministries, children division leader can come also.
Delicia, on behalf of the church, I present to you this certificate of baby dedication, and I hope that it will remind you that you should not neglect to bring Devin to church.
Amen. Very well. We know the song, a new little member has come today. Happy are we?
So on behalf of the children's division, Sister Camplin and all the other teachers, we want to welcome baby Devon into our ministry. And I want to share the same sentiment as Pastor, that you would bring baby Devon. Starts with Sister Camplin, then you're coming to me and Sister Swift, then up to our very dear Sister Jack, and there you go up, up, up with him. So we are encouraging you to bring him out. And you, as Pastor said, you love him, cherish him, and the Lord will do the rest. Amen. Thank you.
Happy are we, happy are we. We give him a chair and ask him to stay. Welcome, welcome again.
Welcome, thank you. Sister Fergus. You see, Sister Fergus, you tried to pull that one off. I was planning to sing at We Can, you know, Sister Fergus. And because of that, I'm changing my mind. For several years, a woman had been troubled
a woman had been having trouble getting to sleep at night because she was fearful of burglars. One night, her husband heard a noise in the basement. He went downstairs, and to his surprise, it was a burglar. He turned to the man and he said, "My wife has been waiting for you for 10 years. Let's go and meet her." Let's pray. Our Father and our God, I ask that you take me into your hands and you cover me, and let your name be glorified and magnified here this morning, is our humble prayer in your Son Jesus' name. Amen and amen. My sermon this morning is entitled, "What Have I Done?" What have I done? Most times when you hear somebody ask the question, "What have I done?" it's mostly saying they are afraid or they are fearful of something that they might have and might not have done. You hear a little child come to you and say, "What now?" He's wondering if he's going to get licks or not. He's wondering if he did something wrong or he did something right. This morning, we have a man by the name of David who asked the same question. He asked the question, "What have I done?" And you may be asking, why did David ask this question? As we go through the Bible this morning, we'll find out why David asked this important question, "What have I done?" Let's turn our Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel. And we're going to read from verse 1. 1 Samuel chapter 20 and verse 1. And the Bible says, "Then David fled from Nayah into Ramah and went and said to Jonathan, 'What have I done? What is my iniquity and what is my sin before your father that he seeks my life?' So Jonathan said to him, 'By no means you shall not die. Indeed, my father will do nothing, either great or small, without first telling me. And why should my father hide this thing from me? It is not so.' Then David took an oath again and said, 'Your father certainly knows that I have found favor in your eyes. And he has said, do not let Jonathan know this, lest he be grieved. But truly, as the Lord lives, and as your soul lives, there is but a step between me and death.'" The Bible started off here by saying that David left north to Ramah. In chapter 19 of 1 Samuel, the Bible tells us that Saul tried to kill David. As a matter of fact, Saul threw a javelin at David, tried to kill him. He did not get through. He went even to his house. His wife had to let him down so that he can escape for his life. I asked the question, why was Saul so mad with David? Well, my friends, God rejected Saul. Oh, yes. And because he rejected Saul, he chose David. And while choosing David, Saul was jealous of David. Because you hear people coming back and say, Saul say 10,000, but David slay 10,000s of 10,000. So Saul was jealous of David because God chose him. David ran from Saul and he went to north. And while he went there, he met with the prophet Samuel. And while they were there, Saul sent 3 persons to get David. But instead of bringing David, they start prophesying. Saul wasn't, what do you call it? He didn't like that. So Saul went himself to get David. When Saul got there, Saul started prophesying. Start stripping and start prophesying. Yeah. While he's there prophesying, everybody asking, is Saul a prophet? Yeah. But then, that's verse 19. In chapter 20, the Bible said that David left Nob. And he went to his friend Jonathan. Okay. When I saw this, when I read this, the first thing came to mind was, is David a madman? Is David really crazy? Because Nob seems to me, from what I've read from the Bible, as a place of safety for David. Because Saul sent 3 persons to kill David, but they didn't get through. He went himself. Instead, they prophesied. But now David is leaving his place of safety to meet Jonathan to talk about his father. It seems as if where David left his place of safety, he was going on the devil's battlefield. And he was going into the camp of his enemy, Saul. No, I said David seems like a crazy man leaving a place of safety. But we do the same thing. We sometimes leave the place of safety and go on the devil's battlefield. We sometimes figure that we are too shadowed, that we are too covered, that we want to experience what is out there, that we want to see what is out there, that we run from under the hands of safety of God and run onto the devil's battlefield. David probably, he was curious. See, that's the reason I don't like technology, you know. David, probably he was saying to himself, well, I want to make peace. I want to know what I've done to Saul. I mean, I marry his daughter. His son is my best friend. What could I have possibly done to Saul that he wants to kill me this bad? Don't Saul know that if he killed me, he won't have a grandchild? And David, he was wondering. And sometimes we ask the same question. We wonder what we would have done to some people, why they don't like us. We wonder what we would have done to some people, why they just try to chastise us every day. But David left the arms of safety to find out what was going on. I believe he left his place of safety because he wanted to make peace. I've come to understand that in our church, we don't like peace anymore. We prefer war. We'd somebody do us something and we rather stay there and fight and cuss for 6, 7, 8 years instead of making peace. But David said to Jonathan, his friend, what have I done? David here is curious. And he's asking his friend Jonathan, oh, Jonathan, what have I done? What iniquity, what sin have I committed against your father? That he hates me this much. I can hear somebody inside here saying this morning, I question God on the same matters. I ask the same question sometimes. I ask God, what have I done? What have I done to deserve this? I've been living all my life. I've served you all my life. I've done all that you asked me to. I gave back my tithes and my offering. I went to visit the poor and the hungry. What have I done to deserve this?
I can hear a mother asking, what have I done? What have my son done to deserve this? Just recently in Trinidad, a couple days ago, an Adventist young lady was killed. I can just imagine the mother asking the question, what have my daughter done? Oh Lord, what have I done? And there are many of us who ask the question. I remember when I went through my troubles, I asked the same question. I did not only ask the same questions, my friend, but I start pointing fingers. I start saying, God, but look there. They're not living right, but I'm living right. I start pointing over there, and I start pointing and pointing and pointing. Because I would have done everything that God would have asked. But yet he allowed the devil to have his way. We ask the question, what have I done? But never once we ask the question, what did Jesus do to deserve the pain, to deserve the agony, to deserve being hanged on that cross? What did Jesus do? Have we ever asked that question? We only see it when it's us. When it's me, what have I done? But when we look at Jesus hanging on that cross, we ask the question, what did he do? He hung on the cross that was meant for you and for me. That wasn't his cross, that was my cross, because he didn't sin, I sin. He didn't mess up, I messed up. But yet, he went on that cruel cross and he died for you and for me. He gave his life so that we can have something better. What have I done? We keep asking, what have I done? What have I done wrong? Where have I gone wrong? But do you understand that sometimes we ask the question, what have I done? Because we want to make things right. Because we want to walk that narrow path. Because we don't want anything to be between us and God. So we ask God, what have I done? Because David didn't just ask, what have I done, you know? David asked about his sin, about his iniquities. Sometimes when we are going through our troubles and when we are going through our trials, we need to ask God to reveal to us what we would have done. We need to ask God to reveal to us our sins that we would have committed. You know, many times when people see you going through your troubles and you're going through your struggles, they just say, retribution. Past sin. That's all they think about. But I remember Job. He asked the same question. He went on his knees and he prayed for his sons. Because he said they might have done something wrong. And sometimes when we see people struggling, something they might have done. When we see the sister in the hospital bed, it's a retribution. We are not seeing, and we can't see beyond, just in front of us. And because we can't see what's on the other side, we start assuming things. It's dangerous to start assuming things, you know. It's a dangerous thing to start assuming this is what happened, that is what happened, and this is what didn't happen. What have I done this morning? Don't you know this morning that we are not fighting against flesh and blood? Amen. Don't you know that the devil is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour? Oh, yes. Don't you know that this morning? Don't you know that we are fighting a spiritual battle? So because we are fighting a spiritual battle, that's why the devil wants to beat upon us. That's why sometimes we go through our heartaches. That's why sometimes we go through our pain. That's why sometimes we go through our troubles. That's why we go through them. And sometimes when we go through our troubles and we're asking, God, what have I done? And God is there comforting us. God is saying to us, it's not what you have done. Just know that my grace is sufficient. Amen. Just know that my grace is sufficient. Amen. When Paul went to him, Paul asked him to take out the thorn out of his flesh. But God said to Paul, Paul, I'm not going to take out that. I'm not going to take out that thorn, you know. I'm going to leave it there. Because you know, I said to myself, God left that thorn in Paul's flesh. So Paul will be reminded who is in control. He'll be reminded that it's not me, but it is God. So God told him, my strength, my grace is sufficient. That's why sometimes we go through our troubles and our struggles so that we can realize and we can understand that it is not me, but it is God. You know, when we do our CXC, our common entrance, youths, and we come first for our school, or we are top. We jump the newspaper, we jump everything and we start beating our chest, it's me. When we get our new job, we jump, it is me. When we get our new house, we jump, it is me. Pastor McDonald, when you get your district, you jump, it is you. But it's not me. It's God. Because you know, sometimes we only claim the good things, but when bad things start happening, we start pointing finger back at God. We start pointing our fingers and we're saying, why you allow this to happen to me? I'm faithful. Why you allow me to be in this hospital? Why you allow me to go through this surgery? Why you allow my mother to die? When there were so many other ladies there in the hospital room who weren't living right, but you allow my mother to die. You allow my sister. You allow my friend. All up this year, my wife would have asked the same question. Why me? When she lay on that hospital bed and she realized there were babies all around playing and she realized God would have took hers away, she wondered what to herself, why me? I'm in a better position to take care of my child. I'm financially better than some. I can show more love and more compassion. Why? But God is saying, don't ask me why, just keep going, because I have a reason for everything. I know why. I'll give you the strength. I'll walk you through. God is just saying, it's because I'm working on you. Have I ever looked in myself and said, well, it's because God wants to get my attention. Sometimes God has to take drastic measures to get our attention. Because there are sometimes God trying to call us. And when he's trying to call us, we want to be up front. So we want to stand up so everybody can see us and everybody can know it's us. So we are showing everybody, this is me. And God is calling, saying, I want your attention. And we are saying, God, no, now is my time to shine. You wait. But God is saying, I want to get your attention. And God do something that he will get our attention. And then when he does that, we ask, why me? But his reply will be, when I was calling, you weren't answering. When I was saying, humble yourself, you thought you were the man. When I was saying, be patient, be compassionate, show some love to others. You were there saying, it's me. I am the man here. I run things. I'm the boss. So David asked, why me? What have I done? It's always good to do some introspection on our lives. David would have asked, what are the sins that I would have committed? There are times when we have to sit down and we have to look at our lives and we have to ask God, have I been doing right? Have I been walking the path, that narrow path that leads to heaven? Is my life in connection with you? Is there something I could have done differently? Whenever you get that answer, act accordingly.
Amen.
Act accordingly. But my friend, David, going there to his friend Jonathan, he wanted to know also if Jonathan had his back. Hello? David leave his place of safety, going to Jonathan, his enemy's son, showing up himself. When you're in battle, you don't show up yourself like that to the enemy. When you show up yourself like that to the enemy, you can get shot. When you're in a warfare, you can't just push out your head out of any window. You can't just run through any door. You have to be careful. Every step you make must be calculated. But David is a smart man.
Amen.
So even if he made himself being vulnerable at this time, he was still smart. I don't know what his plan B, or plan C, or plan Q was. But I believe his plan A was God protecting him again. So David asked, what I have done? What's my sin? Then in verse 3, David said to Jonathan, in verse 3, he went down there and he looked at Jonathan. He said, but Jonathan, even if you say there is nothing, there is but a sleep between me and death. There is just a sleep between me and death. In other words, there's a thin line between death and life. It seems to me that David would have made up his mind that if death comes today, I am ready. Because he went there without his army. He went there without the prophet, who might have been a shield to him. So his mind was made up. Is your mind made up this morning? Is my mind made up this morning? That if death comes my way today, I'm ready to meet my maker. I'm ready to meet my king. There's but a sleep between me and death. There's just a thin line between me and death. There's just a thin line between you and death. It means if there's a thin line between us and death, we have to live right today.
Amen.
We have to make it right today.
Amen.
We can't wait until tomorrow. We can't wait until next week. We can't wait until we say, well, wait until my head cool down. We can't put off saying, I'm sorry. When you know you are wrong, you can't put it off. Because you don't know what tomorrow holds. Belshazzar didn't know what tomorrow holds for him. And that great night, Belshazzar sat there and he drank his life away. He didn't know that was the last moment for his life. He didn't know that was the last day that he will see life. But that day, he drank everything he can. He partied as much as he can. He did all he think he could have done that day because he think that tomorrow was his. But tomorrow is not promised. The devil don't need the devil don't need 2 hours or 3 hours of our lives. All he needs is 1 second. It just takes 1 second for him to snap us like that. It's because of God's protection around us why we have been surviving.
Amen.
Someone may be saying, but I've been doing this. I've been messing up for so long and the devil haven't caught me yet. So I think I can mess up some more. No, that's not safe. That's not safe. Gehazi might have messed up once. Remember the prophet servant when he went and tell what's his name there? Naaman. The king said, give me everything. It might have been the first time he messed up. He probably was thinking about these things long ago, you know. But it probably was the first time he messed up. Look what happened to him. Don't look at people and think, because she getting away with it, he getting away with it, not getting away with it, I can get away with it. Anytime the devil, you give the devil an inch, he takes a yard. And sometimes when he takes that yard, if it's not for the grace of God, you don't come back, you know. The young lady in Trinidad, she probably went into that store a million times before. She probably went in there how much times before? But nothing like that happened. But one day she went in, she never came back out. There's but a sleep between us and death. There's but a thin line. It means that we have to live godly today.
Amen.
Not tomorrow. And Seventh-day Adventist Christians, living godly is not about giving tithes and offering. It's not about dressing good and coming to church. It's not about putting on a show. It's about having love and compassion for each other.
Amen.
There are many of us, we think because we have money, or we think because we have this, all is right. Because we look and we say, but God blessing me. He's giving me this, he's giving me that. Being a Christian is more than that.
Amen.
I always tell people, the time you will know whether you're a Christian or not is whether you can love your enemies. Whether you can love them who hate you. It is easy for me to love my wife because she loves me. But it's harder for me to love somebody who say, oh, man of evil against me. Hey, I have to mount up some guts. I have to push some things aside. I have to fight with myself. But true Christianity comes in when I push me aside and I say, Lord, have your way.
Amen.
I'm not saying somebody do you this or somebody do you that and you have to go back and be boo somebody with them, you know. You have to be smart. But what I am saying is that you have to forgive them.
Amen.
You have to forgive them and you have to treat them like human beings still.
Amen.
Now when you pass them, you skin up your face. Oh, she? Oh, he? There's but a thin line. If death comes your way today, if death comes my way today, how would I stand? How would you stand? Only God knows. I'm not here to try to tell you what will happen to you. But what I'm saying, search your soul. Ask yourself this question. Ask God, what have I done with the life that you gave me? Ask him the question, what have I done to bring glory unto your name? What have I done with the life that you gave me? Am I serving you? Am I walking with you? Am I a witness to you or a witness against you? What have I done with the children that you have placed in care of me? What have I done with the monies that you gave me that I think I worked so hard for? What have I done? You need to ask him. Have you done the right thing this morning? Have I done what's right this morning? Not in my sight, but in God's sight.
Amen.
I pray this morning, like David, we will ask God, yes, what have I done? But we will also ask him to search us. Show us our shortcoming. Show us our sin. And when we reach to the part where we say, Lord, we know there's a short line between us and death, we will say, Lord, if for some reason you take me today, help me to be ready to meet you.
Amen.
Help me to be ready to make it to that heavenly Canaan. If that's your desire and that's your will, stand to your feet.
Amen.
Amen. And amen.
thank God for his love and the grand feast we have had at his table. Amen. Our closing song would be number 600. 600. Hold fast till I come. Hold fast till I come. 600.
Bow head for the closing prayer. Father in heaven, we thankful, dear God, that as much as we have done, you have done even more.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, we know that where sin abound, grace much more abound.
Yes, Lord.
And so, God, we thank you for what you have done and what your son Jesus has done and is doing
yes.
on our behalf, dear God. And so, Lord, we trust our lives into your hands. And we pray, dear God, that you would complete the work that you have begun in us. So, that, oh God, that we will be of that standard and that measure that you approve. And, oh God, that when you return, we would have made us sufficiently ready that we are able to hail you as our King, as our Lord, as our Savior, as our Redeemer, and to live and reign with you through the ceaseless ages of eternity. Lord, as we depart, we pray that, Lord, you continue to not just go before us and behind us, but within us, dear God. And so, Lord, that as friends, our loved ones, as a community behold us, they would not see us, but they would see Jesus in us. Lord, and they would come and taste and see that you are good for themselves, dear Lord. We thank you for the word, and we thank you for the spiritual food. And as we about to eat physical food, Lord, we pray that it would be blessed and it would be nourished. And Lord, that we would be able to praise you with the strength that you have given us and live for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Happy Sabbath. Shalom.